Don't touch anything.
It's the greatest find yet. Nothing compares to it.
But it's definitely something you should hear.
This is The Real Deal with Larry Lawton.
Hey everybody, Larry Lawton here. We got a great show today. I have Ian Bick with me today. We're going to hear all about his great story. We are in G29 Production Studios, and they're really, and I want to thank them before I even start. All right, before I get started, everybody, check us out on YouTube member programs, all the places. Check our cigars out right here. Check them out, thecrookeddiamondcigar.com, crookeddiamondcigar.com. Check them out. Check out the book, Gangster Redemption. It is going crazy. It is everywhere. It is my life story. Now, everybody, I want to welcome Ian Bick. Ian.
Larry, man.
Welcome to the show, man.
Thanks for having me, man.
You know, I was on your show, and I figured to get, you know, we're here in your studios, you guys. You guys are very nice. Everybody here is really good and very professional, and you have a great thing going here. We're going to hear about your story because we're both ex-felons. You know, it's funny. I deal with a lot of people, and when I get into a room and there's more than one felon, I feel okay. So I think that's going to be a lot of fun.
We're the odd ones out today.
I don't know. You know, most of the places I go, there are more felons than there are regular people. Yeah. But Ian, you don't talk about your story too much. But you are you're young now. You're 27 years old now. When you first committed your first crime, Ian Bick, you went to prison for what?
So I was charged on 15 counts of wire fraud, money laundering, and making a false statement. Went to trial, lost about half the counts, and then was found guilty on wire fraud and money laundering, and then got sentenced to 36 months in federal prison, 1 year house arrest, and 3 years supervised release.
At what age?
I was 21. I would just turn 21 when I was sentenced.
So you started your fraud at what age?
So my whole thing started when I was, I accidentally committed this fraud when I was 18.
Okay, bullshit. Now let's call it what it is. Nobody accidentally committed.
When I say accidentally, I meant like I didn't set out with the intentions to commit fraud. It just like everything happened and then it became fraud like in that process. It wasn't like I set out and like came up with this scheme. It just like eloped into that.
I didn't set out to be a gangster. It just eloped into becoming a gangster.
I guess, yeah.
I gotcha.
Yeah.
Listen, you were 19. You ended up owning a nightclub, and that's part of your fraud, obviously.
The nightclub actually didn't really have anything to do with the fraud.
Oh.
The nightclub I owned when I was 18, that was like my second act of life. That was like I screwed up in concerts. The fraud came from I was this concert promoter because in high school, I'm a successful party promoter. I'm making like $10,000 in profit a night as a 15, 16-year-old high school kid.
What are you doing with the money?
Spending it on my friends. I bought myself a car. I bought an Audi. I was having fun.
And let's stop right there. What are your parents thinking?
My parents, they were proud of me. I mean, my mom was like, it's like whatever. And then my dad was like, he's an entrepreneur. He had a catering company. He liked what I was doing. I mean, it was legit. There's no gray area about this except for like tax evasion, I guess. But I have this business and I'm throwing these teen parties. I'm renting.
Now, do you incorporate? Are you registered as a business?
After the first few months, I had partners and there were other 16, 17-year-olds that we partnered up from the town over. We got an LLC, had a whole business account, everything. It was legit. We had an office.
We had an office space?
We had an office space.
Who rents office space to 16-year-olds?
So I worked for this corporate center, a banquet facility. And what I would do is I would help them get business for the proms because the high school prom business is $1 million business. Those proms are so expensive. So they hired me and I would start getting them proms and stuff. And then as a part of working there, because I worked in the kitchen for them, I did all these different things for them. They gave me cheap office space. Signed like a lease. It was like $300-$400 a month. And I had this nice office. It was a suite. It was a luxury suite in this big corporate center. And that's how the business started.
And how are you juggling school? I'm assuming you're going to school.
So by this point, this is like end of senior year. I graduate a semester early, but they don't let me graduate. They failed me by like a half a credit for a class I didn't sign up for. So I had to get a lawyer involved and sue the high school. And we eventually settled out of court with me doing summer school for 2 weeks. But the condition was, if they gave me the diploma, I wasn't allowed to walk at graduation. So they wouldn't let me walk. So I'm done with school by this point. And the semester before, I'm paying kids to do my homework.
And you're at what age is this, 16, 17?
I'm 17 at the time.
So you know, let's face facts. You're a bright student. You're a bright young man.
I wasn't book smart. Like, I was more like smart in the sense where like I hated like the school aspect of it, you know, like the testing and all that. I was more of a thinker and thinking outside the box and that type of thing.
Entrepreneur in its own sense. But okay, so now you take this business, you're making money, which is a party business.
Yeah.
You want to expand that. Now you get out of high school. You don't go to college though.
Don't go to college. And this is actually end of senior year is when I start raising money from friends and family.
And now what was your point? Now, did you, obviously, as a businessman today myself, did you have a prospectus? Did you have a business plan? Did you have any of this nature?
The business plan was like a budget. It was like an Excel spreadsheet that had a budget of what these concerts would cost. And it was, you know, people knew the acts that we were trying to bring, like Wiz Khalifa and these big name hip hop stars.
So you're really a promoter of but high school, high school prom.
Yeah, and I wanted to get into large concerts at different arenas.
So while you're doing this, you have no real business plan, but how much money do you raise to do this?
So the first set of investments we bring in, we raise $120,000. I'm 17 years old, and we have $120,000 in cash in this business account.
Okay, do you know what you're gonna do? Did you show what you're gonna do with this money? Listen, if I invested 10 grand, 20 or 50 grand yeah. into your business, what are you gonna do with my 50 grand?
So this was a very, like, this was all legit, nothing illegal or anything about this. I'll put it into simpler math. So say the show cost $100,000. If you gave me 10 grand, you would get 10% of any profits from that show.
On plus top my of, 10 grand, yeah.
Plus,
yeah.
So if the show grossed 120,000, you would get your 10 grand back automatically because we made that first $100,000, and then you would get 10% of the 20 grand.
Oh, of the profit.
Of the profit.
Oh, okay.
So that would be what, 2 grand or whatever it was. Yeah. So you would get 12 grand back on that investment. So that's what we did. We raised the money, but the show never happened. The show, one of our business partners lied about his connections. It fell through. And we were now at the point where we had to return people's money back.
But let me stop you. So the people invested money into this on a whim. I mean, you never proved that it could be done beforehand with other celebrities or somebody big.
The town was branding me as like this young, successful entrepreneur. They were putting me in the paper. They called me like the Whiz Kid. They named me like top 10, the most fascinating people to look out for. And I was super successful with the teen nights. Like I was literally, this was a business. Like I was making.
Teen night is what? Just a regular party that
so it was. It was high school kids renting. High school kids would pay 10 to 12 bucks. To go to this club that no liquor served. It's an 18 and under party. And the perk of going to this is it's better than going to a school dance where there's administrators and teachers making sure you're not booty grinding. The music isn't, you know, blurred out for explicit music. And kids would come to this. And when you're doing 1,000 or 1,500 people.
Now, this is legit.
100% now, legit.
What are you doing for insurance? If I'm a parent and am I sending my child to this? What happens if somebody's raped at the place or something happens or something? Have you thought about it or didn't even cross your mind?
It was all about the nightclub. The nightclub handled everything. They had the insurance. I was renting this club. Like if you know when you rent a place for your child's birthday party, you're not worried about insurance. So this was the same concept.
Gotcha. Okay, so you got around that part. But you could put on what they want. And the parents said, okay, let's go with it. I mean, if my daughter, which I have a daughter, is 16 and she says, I want to go to this party. Okay, where's the party?
Oh,
at this club.
Parents were not allowing. You would see some crazy shit because I would always be outside, like watching the money in the door and stuff. And girls would come in sweatpants and backpacks. And when they got to the door, they're changing out of the sweatpants into like half naked clothes. They're stuffing in their backpack. They're checking in the bag. Because there's out of, say, you have a group of four girls, there would be one parent that would be chill and the other three would not be chill. So those three with the not chill parents are going to the chill parents' house where they all are, the other parents think they're at the movie theater or the ice arena. There was an ice arena across the street. So they're getting dropped off there that they're walking over. But the club itself, Tuxedo Junction was the name, had a bad rep. for like underage drinking, and parents used to go there as kids, so they knew what goes on there. So the kids would lie, and then they would come, and then it was always funny. I mean, funny seeing this unfold when kids would drink too much. They would pregame in the parking lot and have to have an ambulance come to, you know, pick them up. Not that the club was serving, but they would pregame, and the parents would get pissed, and they would come to the club to meet their kid. And it was a whole big scene. They were like, well, you weren't supposed to fucking be at this club, this and that. And then they would accuse the club.
Nobody ever came to you about that.
No, I was just a promoter.
You're just a promoter, like getting X amount of bucks per head to put it in.
Yeah, years later, they would come when I was the owner, when I became the owner of this club. But I never knew the workings of it at that time.
Okay, so now you're still 18 years old, let's call it,
yeah.
Right?
I'm 17 while this is all going. 16, 17 when I have this business.
16, 17. I love the entrepreneurial mind. So now you're taking the kids, you're saying, okay, where can I go with this from next? What's my next step? How do I either buy the club or how? Now, you must have had a hell of a talk game.
I guess.
I mean, as a young kid, I mean, I'm looking at a kid. If I got a kid who's 17, 18 coming up to me, I'm looking, the fuck does this kid know?
You know what it was? It was my passion. I was super passionate about that. Like, for me, like, people were like, oh, you must have been really confident. I really wasn't. Like, I was confident in what I was doing, but when it came to, like, women or anything like that, I was not confident. When it came to something I was passionate about, like, if you came and sat to me and talked to me today about, like, YouTube, the podcast, this and that, like, I'll go off and I'll start talking about it for hours. When you're coming at me at certain things that I'm not comfortable talking about, then I'm not as confident. I mean, I'm better now that I'm a podcaster and my life is on social media, but before I wasn't like that. So I was just like super passionate about it, and people felt that energy. It makes you believe in something.
I'm like that myself. I mean, obviously when I know something, I get passionate about it, I get behind it, and I go 100%, I call it.
Yeah.
So you do this, you start building up this club. Now you do that, it fails. You lose the $110,000.
No, so I have this $120,000 that we raise. About half of the people pull their money out because they don't want to move forward. The other half leave their money in, and we split it into a string of concerts in the tri-state area, Massachusetts, Connecticut, Rhode Island. They all fail. Every single one of them.
Now, every concert you put on failed. Yeah.
And the
failed where you lost money?
Yeah, significant amount of money.
Now, if you only raise, now you got, I'm telling you, 60 grand left.
Yeah.
You lose that plus.
So what? This is what gets me into the trouble and the fraud. Up until this point, everything's legal. Everything's perfectly legit. And even when the money got lost, it still could have been legit because I didn't raise it based on lies or anything. The first concert we did, I was being told that it was making money and it was profitable. It was this DJ show at the University of Rhode Island. And I'm relaying that to the investors. So look at me like the hedge fund. People, I would raise money and I took that money and invested it into other people, other concerts. And basically in my story, anytime I strayed away from me handling it, it always went wrong. And that was something I had to learn throughout life. But at the time I took the money, I'm thinking I'm successful, and I invest it into another concert company. They're relaying me information that these tickets are selling, everything's good. I'm telling the investors, and we take a limo to the show that night.
Don't you have a check and balance? Like, if somebody says, like, I run show, you know, speaking engagements or whatever.
Yeah.
Well, I want to know, is the money in the account before I want to know anything?
I wasn't even thinking about that. I'm so naive and taking it as their word, because it's just kids dealing with more kids. So the investors are kids. I'm a kid dealing with these other kids that are college kids who I didn't even know had other partners. So the money is going from point A to like point E, and no one knows what's happening.
It's just people throwing their money away, because I don't know investors who do that, but okay. So, keep going.
So the concert I'm thinking is doing well. I bring these investors to the show. It looks packed, everything like that. I didn't know at the time that looks are very deceiving in the concert business. Like, you can make a room look like there's more people than what there actually is. One of the partners to the show has come up to me and they're like, damn, Ian, you know, we took a fucking beating on the show tonight. And I'm like, what do you mean? Like, the place looks packed. You know, we made a bunch of money. I got the emails. He said, no, they miscalculated ticket sales. Expenses went up. Moral of the story, the end of the story, I lost my shirt on that show. I'm now in the position where, and this is the decision I had to make, was A, do I tell them the truth to the investors and say, this is what happened. I was being given false numbers. This is what really happened. But I looked at it as, well, if I tell them that, maybe they think I'm trying to screw them because these are my friends and they think that I'm the show did well and I'm trying to keep the profits for myself. So that was option A. Or option B was because I was so concerned with being like the Whiz kid or the likable and driven. Like my addiction wasn't drugs or alcohol. It was being popular and in that limelight. So do I tell them the truth and risk losing that because now I'm a failure? And so I decided to lie. And that one lie about that show, because in my mind, okay, if I lie to cover this one up, say it made money, give them an imaginary profit, there's five other shows that I can make that money back. I'll just pull the profits from that.
And you're looking like this picture here, I'm going to put up right here.
Yeah.
This picture here with the little mustache. You look like a little,
yeah.
Is that what you're looking like?
That's what I'm looking like at the time. I'm this little nerdy Whiz kid, chubby. I'm not into fitness. I don't go to the gym. I don't do any of that. I'm not into sports. Now, yeah. I'm not into sports or anything. And I lie. And that one lie would affect the rest of my life forever. Just based on that one lie, because that spiraled everything. Once you tell one lie, there's no going back from that. And I was so naive enough to think that the rest of the shows were going to do well. They all tanked. And then after that point, when I go to raise more money, it's based on lies ever since stemming from that first one.
Okay, so the next four shows tank.
Tank.
Did you figure out what you did wrong?
Yeah, I trusted other people.
So you're saying it could have worked, but it was just other people that made the failure, or was it somewhat your failure?
Well, the failure is me not doing anything. Like, I literally sat idle. So I went from this hustler in high school to passing out flyers. I was working the door. I did everything. Like, I got down the nitty-gritty. I did all of that. To now, this kid who thinks he's a fucking corporate CEO sitting in the office making phone calls, not putting in the work. I got lazy. So I passed the money on. I'm not watching ticket sales. I'm not out promoting. I'm not doing anything because these concerts are happening in another state. I don't know the area.
Wouldn't you, again, exactly. Wouldn't you think that I gotta trust somebody either? I don't know this market. I mean, I don't know a person in it. I'm just trusting somebody to do whatever.
I was way in over my head. I thought these were my partners. And what I learned now, looking back on it, it's very hard to get into business with people that don't have skin in the game and nothing to lose. Oh. So when I was funding the whole thing and they get a 50% share of the profits with me, so the way the deals would work was I would fund the whole thing and I'd get 50%, 25% goes to the investors, 25% to my company, and then the other 50% goes to the other production company. That company is not putting up a dollar. So they're not hustling like the way I should have been hustling because I had skin in the game. And that's something I learned looking back on now, is that if the person doesn't have skin in the game, it affects the outcome of that business.
That goes for any business, to be honest.
100%.
You know, I often talked about that. I even talked that to my employees. You got to have some skin in the game.
Yeah.
You got to make more if you make something. You get some ads or commercials or whatever you're going to do.
Yeah.
Make more. It makes you hustle more, yeah. Obviously.
If you're working for that paycheck or whatever, it's not. It's like the difference between a corporate employee and someone that's owning their own business.
So now here you are, 19 years old. It fucking tanks. Ian Beck tanks with all these things. When does it start saying, or you start saying, oh, fuck, what am I going to do? Like, do I quit? Do I take my losses? Do I come clean? Do I... You know, I read an article about you, and, you know, it says you swindled $500,000 of investors' funds.
Yeah.
In a Ponzi scheme. Now, a Ponzi scheme is a little bit different than just a bad investment.
Yeah.
Where does the Ponzi scheme come in?
So, I didn't hear the word Ponzi scheme until the FBI brought it up after I'm already arrested. Like, they didn't, at that time, Bernie Madoff was still fairly new. It wasn't in the curriculum in high school. No one knew what that was. And so what happens is I start, and I never come clean the investors, and I start borrowing from like drug dealers or whatever to pay back that money. I'm just floating money at this point.
Whoa, stop. You can't just say I borrow from drug dealers. How do you know these drug dealers?
So small time drug dealers. I had some friends that worked in the kitchen that I was at the corporate center. I knew he sold weed. So I hit him up. He introduced me to friends. And yes, I started borrowing
how
money.
Much are you hitting up people?
Like 10 grand.
Okay, so 10 grand from this guy, 10 grand from this guy, yeah. 10 grand from this guy.
And I borrow that money to pay these people back.
And now, these drug dealers want their money
back. Now, they want their money at like a 20% interest rate. It was crazy. But my whole logic was buy time, just to pay it. And now these investors, that 60 grand that I lost turned into like 80 or 90 because I said they all made money. So I have to come up with like this imaginary profit. And I'm giving them Excel sheets saying that it made money, this and that.
So at this point, you're forging Excel sheets?
I guess you could say forge. I just put a number saying it made money.
Forging?
Yeah. Yeah.
is what it is.
No, I mean, like, I wasn't altering documents. I just created something is what I mean. Yeah.
I don't know what the difference between altering.
Well, forging, if it was like a bank statement and I like changed numbers.
You have a document, you told them they made money.
Yeah, I said they made money.
And then obviously it didn't make money. So you're going back, changing numbers or whatever document you gave me.
Created a document, and I'm going deeper in the hole.
Right.
From this. I end up paying them all back. I owe these group of people, and then I got lucky. I found an investor, someone that went to my high school that just won a settlement. He sued a gym, lost vision in his eye, and he gave me $250,000 for a concert business.
Okay. He gives you, wow. First of all, I got to say, your game, now you have any prospectus? Do you have any kind of business plan for this $250,000? I mean, you ask a guy for $250,000, you got to get something.
So on the side, while this is going on, I start an electronic business. This is like, the story's kind of crazy because it's going in different directions.
No, it's not. But it's honed in here. We're going to get to it.
I mean, like, at the time period, because this all happened within a few months. Like, this goes from 0 to 100 in like 4 months. This wasn't a year's thing. So this is May of 2013, and I start this electronic business with another business partner. While I'm doing the concerts, right. And my business partner, this is a new business partner, we're best friends. They turn out, they're like these Beats by Dre headphones.
I think I heard of them.
Yeah, so Beats by Dre headphones, and he's saying he could get them for like $50. So they're retailing for almost $400. So I'm thinking, wow, these returns are crazy. So we could promise people a 50% return. So this is where I start borrowing money as a loan. I say, hey, Larry, loan me $5,000. I'll give you $7,500 back in 30 days. If you loan me the money, not invest, just loan as a loan. And that's the interest rate. And my logic is, okay, if we take that $5,000, buy $5,000 worth of headphones, we can, you know, times that by 10. Or whatever.
Quickly. And quickly. Sell them with no time.
On eBay and Amazon or whatever. So I start doing that. And that's how I meet this investor who gives me $30,000, who turns out to be $250,000. He gives me $30,000 towards this. And I give him double his money back in like 60 days.
So you just get $60,000, yeah, in 30 days. Says, whoa, now, I know where I want to put my money.
Now you got to look at what's going. This is the talk around town in the high school and stuff. Everyone just got paid back. Everyone's making 50% of return. Everything's great. You got to invest in
your
business.
You're the Whiz kid.
So I raise like $600,000 over the course of 30 days. All in this business.
Now you raise. How do you raise? Do you go out? Do you put it out on social
media? No, people
are
calling me.
Okay.
Social media is not that big back then. Like Facebook is all right and stuff. Instagram's all right. But it's nothing. I don't have a big platform. I have, 1,000 followers. And they're calling me. Parents are calling me. Everyone's calling me. They want to give me money. I have one parent giving me $50,000. Someone giving me $100,000.
They're just saying, hey, I want to invest in what you're doing.
Yeah, they want to loan me the money for they want the 50% rate of return in 30 days. That's what they want.
What? And you're agreeing to this?
Because I saw the vision with the electronics. What goes wrong here?
I mean, if you came to me and said, Larry, I need $100,000. Yeah. I'll leave you $150,000 in 30 days. My first thing is, okay, if you don't do it, I'm gonna kill you because I'm a criminal and I understand that's unsustainable in any business anywhere on the planet.
Absolutely, but these adults were going for it. And my mindset is not this wasn't a ruse. This is something like I'll always, die on the sword on. Like this 50% rate of return was not a ruse to like get-
So you believed in it?
I believe at the time, now no. But at the time, in that moment when I was pitching these investors early on, when this whole thing started, I 100% believed in what we were doing. But the problem became the electronics turned out to be fake very quickly. So I have all this money coming in. The electronics turned out to be fake and we can't sell them. They're shutting down all the eBay, Amazon accounts. Now instead, of returning the money.
Just to say, hey, listen, I couldn't do it.
Yeah, business is tied up. I decide to keep taking more money at this 50% rate of return. I extend it to like 90 days, telling people, all right, the business is 90 days. It's always just trying to buy more time. And I just booked $250,000 worth of concerts for the fall. So I'm thinking, worst case, if I can't think of another idea to make money, we just put $250,000 into concerts. I just opened my first nightclub called Sky Bar. I'm investing in a shoe business. I'm investing in someone's website. I'm doing these different things. I wanted to be like
doing all of this at once.
My mind is like, I want to be this hedge fund entrepreneur. So we change our name from WB Wholesale to WB Investments. So I'm now this investment company and I'm paying
at 19,
18, just turned 18. And I'm paying myself by, I'm thinking, okay, you know, we need to get a paycheck out of this. Like we're working for the company. So we go on dinners, we go on trips, we buy jet skis, like with the company money. Like I'm just thinking, okay, anything I spend on those personal expenses, I'll pay back in the fall with the concerts. Because on that $250,000 investment on these concerts that we booked, like with big names like Tyga, Chief Keef, all these big acts, it was gonna bring in almost $1 million in revenue if every show sold out. So I'm thinking, okay, every show's gonna sell out, everything's gonna go to according to plan. We lost on our first round of concerts. I know that, you know, that was our mistake. I believed, like, I was very much into quotes and like, you have to fail to succeed. So I'm thinking we had our failure. Let's do this. This is great. And then I, at Tuxedo Junction, the nightclub was going out of business. So I took that over.
Now, do you have employees at this time?
No, it's just me and my business partner, who is my best friend. No accounting. There's no QuickBooks. There's no accountant. Just money goes in the bank account. Whatever, business debit cards.
No secretary, nobody.
We had an intern that turned into being my girlfriend. She became my girlfriend. Yeah, don't fuck your employees. She became my girlfriend. And we're just like, it's just fun, you know? Like we're taking trips. We go to Key West. We go to California with the investors. Like we're making money. Well, we think we're making money. We're not actually making money. It's just like money's going in it. But in my mind, so I met with an attorney. And this is one of our defenses at trial. And we said, listen, can you borrow money? Because at the time I'm 18, no credit. So I said, can we borrow money and use that money as for business expenses and move it around? So in my mind, if Larry, you loan me 50 grand for business expenses, I could use that 50 grand to pay off Bryce, who was another as a loan. You're not investing, hey, Ian, I'm investing into your McDonald's business. And I took it and spent it on jet skis. It was, you're loaning my company money and I'm using that for business purposes, the same way that you would borrow from one credit card to refinance another credit card or whatever. People do that all the time. So that's what I was thinking I was doing. And the issue became was there was no communication for me to say, all these investors who testified at trial thought they were just going to electronics. They didn't know anything about concerts or everything was just bad communication.
Now, was there any paperwork involved with this investors?
Yeah, the investor got a one paragraph loan agreement that said, Larry Lawton is loaning WB Investments 50 grand to get 75 grand back in 90 days. You waive the right to usury. So like, I couldn't say like it's a usurious rate, like it's an illegal interest rate. And that's it. That was a document.
There was no how are you going to spend the money?
No, just that's for business.
So these investors are just stupid.
It's just, I mean
honestly, that's
they stupid. Were taking advantage of the interest rate. That's what
right,
it was.
Right.
The interest rate
greed,
was everything.
Their greed is
and some people
it.
Made some money. Greed does play a factor in this. I mean, I was motivated by greed to like get to that next level. I was greedy and ambitious on that level. The parents that were giving an 18-year-old kid
50 grand, 100 grand,
you know, with no due diligence or whatever. Like that's, you know, I'm not, that doesn't excuse what happened, but that does play a part of it. Greed was a big factor in all of this, what kept it going. So that's what's happening.
And now, okay, when does it start? Okay, now you're really borrowing from Peter to pay Paul.
Yeah.
It's not working.
While I'm waiting for profits to come in from the concert.
From the concert. Now the concerts fail.
Well, so the concerts on paper and on ticket sales were all going to make money. These were actually doing well. They were performing really well. And when I say everything that possibly could have went bad happened, it did. So for instance, we sold out a Chief Keef concert. One example, the gross was like 80 grand that we were making. 40 of it was profit or whatever. He doesn't show up. I lose all that money.
He just doesn't show up.
Doesn't show up. Sends out a tweet the next day saying, sorry, guys, couldn't make it. Doesn't show up. I tried to sue him. It cost me more to sue him than what I was going to get back.
Gosh.
That was just one thing. Then there was an instance with Tyga. We sold all these bus tickets. The show was cost us $100,000 to produce. We're going to make like $160,000 that night. Instead of making that $60,000 profit plus my money back, I got a check cut for me for $11,000, and I lost $89,000 on that one show.
Well, why? Why did that?
So we sold all these bus tickets, and a week before, there was an incident with drinking in another venue from bus tickets on campus. So the dean of the campus said no more buses allowed on campus from out of state school or out of campus schools. We had to refund all those bus tickets and lost it all. This was a couple days before the show because the kids couldn't get to the show. So we lost all that.
Wow.
We had another show.
So this is so far not good luck going on.
This is terrible luck. We had another show we were going to make money where, I don't know if you know much about hip hop shows, but you sell opening spots like ad revenue for a podcast. These are people that are up and coming rappers. They would pay like $5,000 to open for a celebrity rapper. We had like $25,000 worth of openers, right? Guy forgets to collect the money before these guys go on. So we got burned on that money.
How do you forget to collect the money?
Doesn't collect it. These guys perform. We don't get the money. Another instance, a promoter. We did another show.
You got to stop. Who forgets to collect the money?
Larry, this is the worst ran business in American history. We're trying to be these concert promoters that no one knows what the fuck they're doing. There's no business accounting. There's nothing. It's terrible. It's money coming in, money coming out. The thing's a shit show. So every concert fails that was going to do well. So I'm spending money thinking these shows are going to do well. And I'm not telling investors because there was always one more show to back it up. So like the Chief Keef show, okay, big whoop. We lost that money. We have the Tyga show that's going to bring in the money to make it back. And eventually we get to the end. This is December now. This goes from May of 2013 to December of 2013. And I'm $1.2 million in debt to investors with interest. That's with that 50% rate of return.
Oh my gosh.
I'm now borrowing from shady fucking people through the nightclub business. Like I would go to these drug dealers, biker gangs that I'd meet, and they would be dropping off like duffel bags of cash because I would be, they wanted me to clean their money essentially with these loans. Like they would give me money and I would give them a check back or whatever. I'm using cash to kind of float payments. It's a mess. So I'm 18 years old and I owe all this money. And
aren't you scared of borrowing from like biker gangs?
I was
just
trying
dealers?
To stay alive and float. Like I never wanted to fuck anyone over. I just wanted to keep things going. I wanted to keep this operation going until something came, until I had the next big idea. But then December hits and there's no more concerts. There's nothing to bank on. And there's just nothing to do. So I finally go to a lawyer. And I tell him everything. This is a family friend.
Is this a criminal defense attorney?
He is a civil attorney.
How do you know him?
He's my dad's friend.
Okay.
And he had helped me against the Chief Keef case, like to litigate against Chief Keef. And he helped me when Sky Vodka sued me for having the name Sky Bar. They sued us for that, for a copyright.
And you won.
What?
You won that?
No, we lost. They offered us $10,000 and he dropped the ball and we didn't get the $10,000. Yeah.
So the lawyer dropped the
ball. The lawyer dropped the ball because we didn't.
But you got him back now.
So I got the lawyer. The reason why I went to him is because I'm all this money in debt, and he said he was gonna cover, like he had my back in legal fees because he's a family friend. So I meet with him, I tell him everything. He says, don't talk to the investors, let me handle it. So I give him a list of everyone that's owed money, and he sends a letter to all these investors. Most of them are high school kids or college kids. And he says, WB Investments is unable to pay you. We're analyzing it. Please stay tuned for further instructions. He goes over all the numbers. He calculates what makes sense. Like, okay, if someone invested $50,000 out of pocket, but got $100,000 back, then they don't owe any money. We don't owe them any money.
Right, right. You're cutting, you're figuring out what everybody's worth.
What the net loss was. So he sends letters to some people saying they're owed zero. Technically, they owe us because they made a profit. This pissed everyone off because people, kids, imagine you're 18 years old, you invested $1,000, right? and that on paper ballooned into 20,000 because you kept rolling it over. They think that's their entire life savings. They're not out 20,000, they're only out a grand, but they think it's like their life savings.
Yeah.
These kids get pissed because I'm not answering my phone. My lawyer says, don't answer, don't talk to anyone. They go to the police. They go to the police station and all these groups of kids, and the police are looking at it like, wow, one investor's out 250,000. All these people are owed money. This has to be like this huge, they think it's like the next Bernie Madoff case, like this huge thing. We go in for an interview with them and they think their first accusations, this is before they had the bank records, are like, we think that you're running a drug business, you spent all the money at Universal Studios, you're hiding real estate, like all this shit, because this is what the kids are feeding to them. Because the kids all think, I genuinely scam them, I'm sitting on the money, because I own the nightclub. Like, no one knows how things really work. Like, it's not like I own the building.
100%. Yeah. 100%. That's normal.
Yeah. It put gasoline on the fire, though. And that's how the investigation starts at the local level.
Now it's a local level. How does this get into the FBI?
That is a $1 million question.
Oh, come on.
I do have some sense, like, through what I've heard from my lawyers. There was this detective that, you know, like in every big fraud movies, there's like that hardcore detective that's after the person, to like Wolf of Wall Street, that one detective that focused on him.
On the boat.
There was this detective like that who, he was relentless, had it out for me from the get. And he went, from what I've heard through the grapevine, is that the state's attorney declined to prosecute it. They said it's a civil matter.
Let these people sue him civilly.
Yeah, let him sue it. It's a kid, kids dealing with kids' money, sue it, whatever. Had it been a state case, I probably would have just got probation, whatever, yada, yada, wrapped up. He's able to bring it to the U.S. Attorney's Office, who looks at it, and they're thinking this whole time, this whole case stemmed on them thinking there's millions of dollars at play. I don't know to this day if they would have pursued it to the ends that they did, had they realized early on it was that amount of money, because the feds don't, it's not a lot of money. It's $500,000 out of pocket.
That's not a lot for the feds. I mean, that's not even a fucking...
Yeah, they're after millions, you know? So I think that propelled it, that they pushed that, and they said that there was drugs involved or this and that to get them started. I also think that the feds thought that it was going to be an easy open-close case of me taking a plea deal, and that would be the end of it, because they invested more than $500,000 to prosecute this, 100%.
Absolutely.
So it then gets to the postal inspectors, the IRS, the FBI, the Department of Banking, just like five organizations.
Well, you know, you are public enemy number one.
Exactly. And that's how this all unfolds and it all happens. And they investigated for a year before they indicted me.
Now, okay, in the meantime, this is going on. You go underwater, obviously. What are you doing with yourself?
I come up with the idea to reopen the back room of Tuxedo Junction.
Now, Tuxedo's a junction, a bar that you own.
Oh, I own the front room. It's divided into three rooms.
Okay.
And the front room's not making any money. It's just breaking even. So now, it's
do you own them all?
I didn't physically own. I just own the business.
So you rented all the rooms?
Yeah, I rented own the back two rooms yet. I didn't rent them yet.
Okay.
I get the idea. This is March 2014. I'm just about to turn 19. And I get the idea to go back to my roots. I said, listen, I was successful at this building doing what I knew how to do. Why can't I do that again? So I get the idea to reopen the back room. I'm down to the nitty gritty. I'm doing all the painting myself. I'm clearing the place out with a dumpster.
You got no money coming in.
No money. My dad's helping me when he can a little bit here and there. And I'm just grinding. I have a couple friends helping me. And I had some family members from my dad's side of the family help pay the first artist, the artist fees, the rent money, things like that. And I turn it in this whole year from this nightclub that no one knew about to one of the biggest nightclubs for electronic dance music on the East Coast. We were booking.
I just went to one of those shows down in Miami.
Yeah. You know, we were booking like the Chainsmokers, Bass Jackers, Steve Aoki, Zed's Dead, Adventure Club, all these big names. And this business is generating revenue. It's bringing in money. The problem is I always mixed good money with bad money. So if I had one concert that made money, I took that money instead of putting it back in the business to pay electric, pay bills, use it for a deposit for another thing. I'm taking that money and paying off old people. There was no separation.
Trying to just like keep your name somewhat good.
Yeah, at this point, I'm doing accounting now. I got everything on track. This is a legitimate business. There was nothing illegal about the club. It's building, and obviously it's a brand new business. There's going to be some losses. So you mix that in with bad debt, it was a recipe for disaster. And I could never get it off the ground. But I ran that for 2 years through being indicted. The cops were after me. They were raiding it all the time. They were always looking for me selling drugs or selling the minors.
You never sold drugs, right?
Never sold drugs. I never did drugs, never sold them. We sold to alcohol illegally, you know, not to minors, but just illegally without a permit.
You did.
Not to minors, just...
No, like yeah. me.
So, like...
If a gangster like myself came in to
sell
me...
If you wanted a bottle, we'd sell a bottle of, you know, Ciroc for $800. We needed the money. So we sold it. One night, this is my favorite story. We knew they were catching on to us with the bottles and stuff. So we bought like 500, 600 Gatorade bottles. Took all the red ones. We bought red Gatorade bottles. Made a big batch of jungle juice. Poured it out. Put the jungle juice in it and sold it for $5 or $10 a bottle at the club.
Jungle juice.
And the cops raided it and didn't know to check the Gatorade bottles because it's dark in the club.
But those Gatorade bottles were actual...
It was jungle juice, yeah. We flipped
alcohol.
The yeah, and we were selling that the whole night and we made crazy
And nobody
money.
Told on you? I
mean, no one told.
That, you know, that's normally how it happens.
Eventually they found out, but we were done by that point.
Okay, now when do you get arrested and how does the arrest go down?
So I got arrested in January 2015. This is a year now that they're investigating. I'm running the club. I just got back because I'm a big gambler at this point. I'm using the money to help fund the club. I play Baccarat.
I used to play Baccarat and yeah. Blackjack and Baccarat. Yeah. I was big in Atlanta.
I love Baccarat. It's a great
Number
game.
Number nine. monkey.
They would call the Asians there because it's a big Asian game. They would say, young boy, the best. They would call
monkey.
Me young boy.
That's
yeah.
Asians, monkey.
And so I get back at 4 a.m. and
from Atlantic City?
No, it was Yonkers Raceway, Empire City.
Oh, my God. Well, I got to stop you. Yonkers Raceway?
Yeah.
I used to go to Yonkers. Spot, right? I used to go to Yonkers Raceway in the 70s.
Yeah.
And we used to race that. We used to make Yonkers Raceway from where I lived in the Bronx in about 12 minutes. We raced to Yonkers to get the race because they had the trotters. I don't know if you know anything about horses, but the
trotters. Yeah, a little bit. I never really got into betting on horses.
So anyway, Yonkers racing. So Yonkers is a gambling casino now?
Yep. So MGM actually just bought it recently. But
wow.
I'm going to Yonkers because Connecticut casinos are 21 plus. I'm 19, so I went to Yonkers. And I would
is that
be
18
able,
plus?
Yeah, I'd be able to. It's all electronic games. I would turn $500 into $30,000 on this Baccarat.
But when you won.
When I won more times than I lost.
Did you really?
Oh, if you look at the course of my career there, I won way more times than I lost. Because a lot of the times I was just taking the winnings to keep playing too. So if I lost the winnings, I didn't really count that as a loss. But I would go and I would make good money. I would never leave there with less than $10,000 on my good days. Obviously, there are bad days, but that didn't...
Just to say, you lose your money on a bad day, what are you going to do?
No, but it wasn't to the point where I was going there. I never went there with 20 grand and lost it.
Okay.
If I went there, it was with 2 grand, I would lose that.
Okay.
I would always... There would be a lot of days where I brought 2 grand, made it to 15, and left with zero, but that's still only a 2 grand loss.
I got you.
That was just me being a fucking degenerate and couldn't walk away from that.
Exactly. Okay, at least you know that.
Oh, yeah. So it wasn't a sustainable business, but that's just what... It was keeping me afloat. I did what was working for me. And I would use that to get me out of situations with drug dealers, to get me out of situations with artist agents, whatever. You know the entertainment business. You don't pay them, you're blacklisted.
Done.
To this day, every single agent I've ever worked with got paid back. And so they can't say anything bad. You know, they got their money, every artist I ever worked with.
Okay.
And so I get back at 4 a.m. that day and... I'm in my boxers.
4 a.m. Yeah. You're at your house?
I'm at my parents'
house. Where
do
you live? Your parents?
I'm living with my parents, yep. And there's like a loud banging on the door by like 5 a.m. or come 5, 5:36, whatever. It's early in the morning. Loud banging at the door. And by this point, I've been arrested like 3 times already, but by the state, the Danbury police, the local town police for liquor violations, whatever.
Now, when you were arrested by them, it wasn't during the morning or
anything. It was just like I would be at the club and they would see me and they would pick me up. They were like, hands behind your back, we have a warrant for your arrest. And the paper kept putting this in the news, this and that. So this morning.
So now you're this notorious. I mean, you must have been.
There was a new article every week, Larry. You look up my name. I mean, now it's more in favor of my direction because I'm bigger on social media. All that stuff pops up. But before you look it up, it was bad. Like, there was a lot of shit. You're this
gangster kid.
Yeah. So I look out the window. My bedroom window faces the outside. I look out. There's an IRS agent right outside the window. The street is lined with SUVs, local police department cars. Like, it's lined up and down, up both ways. Agents.
This is outside. When you look out the window when they're banging out on your door.
Yep, because we have lights outside, so I see it. There's agents outside the house. There's banging. I hear my parents running down the stairs to get the door. I'm like, fuck. I'm thinking about what to do. They rush in. I hear them say, step aside, get the dog back. Yeah, tell my parents. They're like, where is he? They're looking at doors. My door's still shut. I'm sitting there in like shock. I'm in like panic. I don't know. I'm just frozen on my bed, sitting down in just boxers. I'm rushing to put a t-shirt on, and they bush in the room and they're like, Ian Bick, put your hands behind your back. You're under arrest. You know what this is about. I have no idea. It's the feds. It's not even registering that I see like the IRS or the FBI jackets, because it's a joint task force. IRS, FBI, everyone. It's there. Local police.
Marshals,
everyone. And they got guns, the whole shebang. And it's not registering to me, because in my mind, my lawyer told me, because I have a paid lawyer by this point, he said, listen, we're going to just turn your... They're going to indict you. I knew for months I was getting indicted. They were doing the grand jury selection. We declined a plea deal. And they had a hard-on for me, but he said, listen, you'll be able to just turn yourself in. We'll let you know when the indictment comes. So I wasn't expecting this big raid, but they were pissed off that I was still running the club, doing all this kind of in their face. So they arrest me. Worst thing I could have done in that moment, they grabbed my phone. That's what they had a warrant for. They said, put in your password.
You did?
I put in my password.
Oh!
Yeah.
I just talked to somebody about that.
I put in
Don't
my password.
Ever give your password to your phone. Ever.
I've heard mixed reviews whether they could actually get into it or not. But I hear what
illegally, maybe, but they have to have a warrant for it. Did they have a warrant
for it? They had a warrant for the phone, but it's not like I had it. The warrant doesn't say you have to give up the password.
No,
they gotta get that shit on their own.
Absolutely.
I made it easier for them. So I give up the password. It's snowing outside now. It's cold. It's January.
Yeah.
They haul me out of the house, but they don't just put me in the car. They sit me on the steps of my house.
I did that to me.
Yeah, and I'm in cowboy
boots.
You're
freezing your balls off.
I'm just in a t-shirt. I said, can I brush my teeth? They said, no. I'm in cowboy boots because I didn't have shoes with laces or whatever, without laces. So they put me
in
cowboy boots.
You're in underwear and a cowboy boots.
They let me put jeans on.
Oh, okay.
I got a t-shirt on, no jacket, nothing.
Freezing.
Sitting outside. And they keep me outside because they're waiting for that main detective to come. They want that one detective. Sitting there for 10 minutes, he finally comes up and he says, you remember me? That's what he said. Like, it's a famous line in the movie. Like, oh, we got you now. Put me in the car. We drive 45 minutes, snowing out. They got an armed postal inspector in the back seat, two agents in the front. I'm driving in this car. We go all the way to Bridgeport. And then they find out that the magistrate judge, couldn't make it to Bridgeport, so they had to take me to New Haven. I'm in the car for like 4 hours. Finally get in there, go to holding. My lawyer meets me. I'm like, dude, what the fuck? I didn't think this was supposed to go down this way. I was supposed to turn myself in. Go through all that, get released on bond.
You had a bond. What was your bond?
$250,000.
Now like, you had the money?
No. So in the feds, you don't put up the money. It's just my parents just had to sign.
Right, for their house or whatever.
Yeah, but they're not like transferring the deed or anything. It's so easy. I get out, the news, man. Everywhere. Reuters, Yahoo News, Vice. The headline is Danbury nightclub owner, teenage nightclub owner, runs a Ponzi scheme, arrested by FBI, IRS. The headlines are everywhere. That helped my business so much. We sold out of concert tickets for the next 2 weeks. Because of the press. I had NBC, so my lawyer's like, don't talk to the news or anything. I get
now. Now you're back working still.
I own the club. That's my job. So I go back to the club.
But you sell out.
What do you mean sell out?
You said you sell out concert tickets.
Oh, yeah. So I'm selling out concert tickets. So I go back to the club that day. I get indicted. I go back to the nightclub because I'm putting my energy into working. And you should, social media, the kids I went to high school with are lighting me up. They're saying, look at this, like it's breaking news, like in the small town, you know? They're like, oh, he's still in jail, he's fucked. They don't realize, no one knows how this shit actually works. So I'm at the nightclub and NBC News calls me and they're like, hey, we're outside the club, like, would you be willing to do an interview? And you would think like I would call my lawyer or anything like that. I'm like, fuck it, come in. So they come in, give them credit, they videotape the whole club. I do an exclusive interview. And they put the video footage of the nightclub in there and it helped sell out tickets. They brought it up at trial though that I did this interview. But it was great exposure. All these press things are covering me. And I ran the club for the next 2 years after that. I went on trial 10 months later, 11 months later. And then I got sentenced a year after that.
Oh, so when you were, okay, you ended up going to trial a year later.
I went to 10 months later. It was November of that year.
You get convicted?
Get convicted on it. They charged me on 15 counts. One they dropped, six I lost on, six
false
guilty.
False statement?
I won that one. They not guilty.
I got charged with that.
Yeah. not guilty.
18 USC 1001.
Yep, and they got me because they entrapped me. Because when I first met with the postal inspectors, they didn't let me know that I should. They said, you don't need a lawyer. Like, you're good. They hit me with that. And juries do not like, in any case, no matter how serious the case is, juries do not like when they take advantage of someone that is unknowing and that they don't like that. Yeah.
So now you, when you get convicted, you go to jail right away?
No, I was released back on bond. And I...
For why?
Just, I wasn't a flight risk, wasn't a danger to the community. I was running my business, still the nightclub.
So the judge says you can go back out and work and report at
it's
another...
It's not like the state where you get found guilty and you're taken away immediately.
Well, it depends. It depends.
It does depend, but he let me on bond. And at this point, the government had tried to get my bond revoked like six times. They lost every time. They said, at one point, the city of Danbury was extorting me. They told me I couldn't operate the nightclub without paying for EMS services. So I was, this is another reason why the business didn't work out. I was paying $5,000 some nights for EMS. So the head of the EMS for Danbury Hospital was charging me to keep his staff there. And what they were doing was they were taking that money and then they were billing the people that got taken to the ambulance, the insurance companies.
And they shouldn't have been.
They shouldn't. They, by law, they're, and the federal court ruled, they have to be there regardless. If you, something happened to you right now, I call 911, they have to show up.
Sure.
But back then they were saying that they should already be there, but that doesn't make sense. It's not like if we're doing an event right now, we're gonna automatically have the ambulance here and something happens to you. So I stopped paying them.
Wow.
But the feds tried to jam me up because I stopped the payment on the check. They said I was committing fraud, this and that, but I won all those little battles. A year goes by, almost a year. And my business partners or kids that were helping me out at the club that I thought were my friends found out I was going out of state to gamble at the casino again. Because I, at this point...
That is on paper. I mean, you're already convicted.
I'm convicted. I'm on pretrial.
And you know you're going to jail.
Out of state. No. I don't know. We're
oh,
thinking...
Oh, this is pre-sentence.
Pre-sentencing. Yeah, I'm thinking, you know, we could get house arrest or whatever.
How long was the sentence? Like, how long between conviction and sentencing?
A year. 11 months.
You had a 12-month sentence, like conviction to sentencing?
So there's a lot of delays. I mean, in the feds. So I got convicted.
Now, you're in the middle of this. You're doing PSI and all that.
So that was way later. I got convicted in October, right? Or November of 2015. The first sentencing date was March of 2016. That got pushed back to May, which got pushed back to July, which got pushed back to August, and then eventually October. There's a lot of delays, a lot of things, you know, that you
can
push
it. I mean, I get it, but usually they don't with
you. Yeah, but I'm on bond this whole time, so it shows like I have a good rapport with the court, this and that, and I go out of state to gamble to keep my, because my logic is I need to make the nightclub work so I could sell it, pay everyone back. Like that was my main goal, generate enough revenue to build the name, sell the nightclub, get back to even. That's all I cared about. I'm also working at Whole Foods at the time. I worked at a Chinese restaurant. I worked at Whole Foods. I'm hustling.
Well, you do have a work ethic.
Yeah. People could say whatever they want about me, but at the end of the day, I had the work ethic. Like, I was willing to put in the hard work. So I'm working
whatever
at Whole Foods. Yeah, whatever. Working at the Chinese restaurant, working at Whole Foods, whatever. friends find out I'm going out of state and they say, we want to take the club away from Ian. So they call the FBI. They give them a tip that I'm going out of state against my bond. They file a report with the court. I have an emergency bond hearing and I end up getting my bond revoked a month before sentencing. Judge says the party's over. You're going to be remanded into custody. And they bring me to the Wyatt Detention Center in Rhode Island, the private prison.
So you go from, okay, automatically, you didn't know you're going to be revoked.
No, I got the emergency. If I had known I was going to jail that day, I probably would have ran. But
no. Yeah. Oh, my God. Or
looking back on it now, I wish I caused, like, a scene. Like, imagine if I was, like, on top of the roof with tuxedos and there's, like, a hole, like, because it was a big
roof.
What,
you would have jumped?
No, not jumped. I'm just saying, like, if the cops had to come up there, like a news flashy, like a newsworthy story. I don't know, boy, something, you know?
You're around theatrics. Social media too long. Hold on.
I don't know, man. Hold on.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. So now you are arrested. Yep. You are going to federal prison.
Bond revoked. I go to this detention center in Rhode Island. This is a
Rhode
month.
Island.
In Rhode Island. This is
that
month.
Far from here?
2 hours.
Okay. So you go to Rhode Island. You are going to federal prison.
Yep. Now but I don't know for how. Was it sentenced? So it's limbo. That's a scary state to be. You know what that feels.
Absolutely.
That's why you're in limbo.
When do you go to sentencing hearing?
A month later. I go to sentencing.
And what are you sentenced to?
So the guidelines were 9 to 11 years.
9 to 11 years?
Yeah, if you go off the sentencing guidelines, my guidelines were 9 to 11 based on losing a trial, all the enhancements, everything. The PSI put me at 9 to 11. I fucking hate the PSI because they put me with a probation officer that wasn't my pretrial supervisor officer, knew nothing about my case, and literally took everything the government said and put it into the PSI.
Yeah, 100%.
And all this stuff, like nothing accurately depicted me in the PSI. And looking back on it, the only thing I wish I did was, I wish I said I had drug use.
Of course, that would help me. The program and everything.
So 9 to 11 years I'm facing, the government is asking for 6 to 7. My lawyer is asking for house arrest.
Okay.
Probation and house arrest.
Now, it's very rare that you see the recommended guidelines at 9 to 11. And then the feds asking for less than that. And then you asking for shit time served.
The feds acknowledged, which the PSI also acknowledged, that my age warranted some type of departure. Right. Just something. They everyone was on the same page at the age aspect.
Sure, you're a kid.
Played an effect.
Okay.
But the feds weren't 100% sold. So the judge departs 50%. 50% departure.
So 9-11, he goes down to 4 to 5.
Yeah, because in his mind, you do the 3 years plus a year house arrest and the 3 year supervised release. So he was he looked at that year house arrest.
When they did us, it was the time they gave you was the time you're doing in the joint, not counting the paper.
No, I think he looped everything together, and that's how he came up with that sentence. And in my mind, I'm like, fuck, because he said 36 months. I'm like, how long is 36 months? Because when you're saying someone years, you don't say, hey, my birthday is in 36 months. You know,
don't get that. When I was sentenced to 144 months,
you're sitting there calculating it.
Oh, fuck, that's 12 fucking years.
Yeah, so I'm like, fuck, you know? My mom's crying in the courtroom. It's just like, it's not a good situation. I spoke at my sentencing.
Now, was the press there?
A lot of press with the Danbury News Times reporter. I'm like, you're a fucking asshole. Because the thing that I didn't like about Danbury, they would always put out an article. They would never call me for my side of the story. And when I would call with them, they said, we couldn't get a hold of you.
The day
they finally gave me a fair article was the day the HBO Max documentary came out, which discredited every article they've ever written, because every article was always the fraud had to do with the club, which wasn't true. So HBO Max does a documentary and it turns out the fraud had nothing to do with the club and it discredited all their articles.
Sure, it had everything to do with just the bad concert promotion.
That's when
they
call me and we do a sit down interview and they finally did
a
better piece. It wasn't like it's a local newspaper, you know.
Yeah, fucking.
But it wasn't like a bullshit one. They still put their government shit, but for so long it was always one side of the story and never both.
Okay, so now Ian is arrested.
I'm arrested. I'm brought back.
Sentenced to 36 months.
36 months
in federal prison.
Yep.
You're a nonviolent offender. What's going through your mind? Like, what the fuck am I going to do? I mean, what's going through your mind?
So I like a lot of kids, I guess my age, watch like prison shows, stuff like that. I never watched any of that. I watched Orange Is the New Black, I guess, at that time. But I didn't watch I didn't watch 60 Days In, Wentworth, anything like that. So I have no idea. I'm thinking the prison is going to be like the detention center I'm at, which is this private facility. You're locked in your cell most of the day. Like, it sucked. Like, that is what you picture. Like, when you hear the word prison, you're thinking that. So I'm thinking that. I have no idea what to expect.
Why is it different from my year? We're doing a video on that one.
I get brought to Brooklyn. They transfer me like a couple
MDC?
Days.
MDC?
That's my second ever pit stop.
Oh, and now you're bringing my hometown.
They put me on a bus from the Wyatt Detention Center in Rhode Island to Brooklyn. And I'm thinking like it would just be more direct. You go from Wyatt to your designated spot, you know? And the whole time,
wake up.
I'm interacting with my lawyer. He said, you're going to a camp, you know, don't worry. Your points are low enough. You're going to be at a camp. No problem. He's calling his BOP connect because all these lawyers have connections, this and that. He's saying, you're going to go to a camp. No problem.
Yeah, but they don't know shit.
They don't know shit. Yeah. I think the biggest media bullshit there is about prison is when at these celebrity sentencing and the lawyers are like, we request that you're, that my client goes to so-and-so camp or whatever, and the judge says, I recommend this, and then the
means
news...
nothing.
Yeah, the TMZ writes, he's going to be designated to this camp. That doesn't mean shit. The BOP could do whatever the fuck they want
and
to.
And they do.
Yeah, they
often
do.
Often they really don't give a fuck. In fact...
I think they'd want to do the opposite.
I was just
if I ever
say.
Go through it again, I'm requesting something the worst of the worst, and they'll put me in a better one. So I go to Brooklyn.
Ian, stop that. Don't do it again.
No, I would never. So I go to Brooklyn and I'm there for 2 weeks. And Brooklyn, I didn't think it could get any worse than the private facility I was at. It gets worse. Brooklyn sucked, man.
Of course it
does. The food was terrible, small portions. The showers were dirty. I did find a couple guys I'd play with Monopoly with all day that passed the time. But you're in limbo. You don't know where you're going. You have no idea. There's no counselors and case managers. I feel bad for the people that do their whole time there. I was in a cell with one guy. He was there for 6 years. I was like, how do you do 6 years here? Come to find out, he's one of the biggest snitches for the Mexican cartel, which is why they had him at MDC Brooklyn. Yeah. But I don't know how people do their time there because the case managers are like in a different, they're not in the pod itself. So there's, you can't get a hold of anyone.
The whole building, it's a fucking whacked out place. First of all, MDC, you have New York and you have MDC Brooklyn. And
in Manhattan. Yeah.
And it's just.
It was terrible.
They are two facilities that are just.
Yep. So then one day the bus comes, picks me up early, like 4 a.m. I'm like, thank God, I'm finally getting out of here. I'm going to a camp. They say, you're going to Fort Dix. So my lawyer had told me.
There's a camp at Fort Dix.
Yeah, so my lawyer said, you're going to Fort Dix. I was like, great, I'm going to a camp. They put us on the bus. I go to Fort Dix. Well, they weren't bringing me to the camp. They were bringing me to the low at Fort Dix.
Oh, and now, obviously, I drove through the camp at Fort Dix on a bus.
Yeah.
Being in a maximum security prison, and I'm like, what the fuck is this? It looks great, man. Yeah. Even the low would look like a fucking...
Well, Fort Dix is has a fence, or the camp has a fence, too. Some camps don't even have a fence.
Right.
But they
now,
have a fence.
There's a lot of inmates there, too.
Yeah, so Fort Dix has 2,500 on each side. There's an east side and a west side, and then the camp has 500.
And that's the low?
Yeah, the low.
There's 5,000 inmates at the low?
2,500 on each side. Yep.
Wow.
It's an old army barracks.
I know. Yeah. I know Fort Dix.
So I'm there. I'm like, they got me in the wrong place. I'm at the wrong place. Like, this is barbed wire. This is a prison, you know? And I don't know anything about mediums or pens or whatever. So I'm thinking this is bad. There's like mean looking guys. Like, I'm scared, you know? Like,
you're a kid.
Yeah, you're in these 12-man rooms. It's open. I'm realizing, though, there's so much freedom. Because when you go from MDC to a place like Fort Dix, there's pool tables. It's like a college. I compare it to a college campus. You have the chow hall. You have basketball courts. You have a track. You have all
the yard.
It's a fucking civilization. There's different buildings. It's crazy.
There's a lot of shit going on there.
Yeah. Oh, everything. They say that's like one of the most industrialized compounds for, you know, money ecosystem. Like I talked to some guys there. They'd rather be there because they're making money and sending it out of the country. The
matter
Mexican
of fact,
guys,
I was just going to say, foreigners do that. They did that in all the prisons.
The ICE guys don't want to go to the ICE facility. They'd rather spend their time. I got
pissed. Okay, so you're in Fort Dix prison. Now, it's a low, but you don't belong there. At least you don't think you belong
there. I don't think I belong there, but when the first time I met with the case manager, I was at 12 points. You need 11 to get to the camp. And I think where they screwed up was, like, they said I didn't graduate high school because I didn't have the diploma yet. I think that set my points up
a little
bit.
And that gave you higher points.
Well, what really fucked me was my age. You get like 5 or 6 points just for being under 25.
Matter of fact, you know, I often tell, if you're a violent offender and you're under 25, you're automatically going to a penitentiary, actually.
Yeah. It's, you know, crazy.
It's crazy. And in fact, that's wrong, because they're only teaching them how to be more violent and more crazy.
Yeah, the age thing is a huge factor. Like, if I, God forbid, had to go back to prison now, I'd go to a camp. You know, I wouldn't go to...
Will you stop talking about going back to prison in any fucking way? So, Ian, let's get back. So you now are in prison. You got 36 months. You're going to survive this. You don't give a shit. You're going to fucking... okay, what do I got to do? Do you get visits? Do you, who's visiting? Do you have a girlfriend at the time? Do you have your parents, obviously?
No girlfriend. My dad.
Smart.
my dad's coming to visit me in New Jersey. He comes and visits me a few times. My mom comes once too. I had two friends, only friends that ever visited me in prison. They came to see me when I was in New Jersey. And, you know, I was getting into a routine. Like, I hung out. I had a couple good, like, cellmates, bunkmates. It just developed a routine, I guess you could say. Started working out, played a lot of spades. Spades was my game.
How about pinochle?
No, hated pinochle.
Yeah, because it's a smart man's spades. You do know that, right?
Yeah, I know. And I played dice. I played CeeLo.
Okay.
I was a big gambler for CeeLo, so I loved to do that. And
stamps.
I would play there all night with stamps and mackerels, and that was fun. And then eventually, I got caught up in an investigation for cell phones.
Now, you know, I have to stop you here, because when I was in prison...
Yeah.
If you got caught with a cell phone, that's an escape charge, especially a penitentiary. Literally an escape charge. You're going to, not only the hole, you're going big time.
Back to court.
Yeah, it could be. I'm hearing now, because it's like, it's not even a series one shot. You know what a series one,
yeah,
series
one, two? Yeah, 100 series.
Yeah. So you get caught with a cell phone, or you're just under investigation with the cell phone?
Well, so with the cell phones, I think there was at Fort Dix, no one was really getting charged for cell phones. It would be a 100 series shot, and you would go to the shoe, you would get sentenced to shoe time, and most of the people that got caught with the cell phone were already either at low points but couldn't go to a camp because of their criminal history, or at like 12 points. So when they got caught with the cell phone, the 100 series shot brought them at like 17 or whatever, which was still... low points or whatever.
So they weren't even going up to another higher school.
No, but if they were
going back on the yard?
They would go back on the yard after they did their whole time, because they could sentence you to shoe time.
Did they have a hole there?
Yeah, they had a shoe there. It was a big shoe. Whole separate building. Like,
oh, yeah, yeah.
It's like two
floors. I've never been to a low.
Yeah, it was like 2 or 3 floors. It was a big shoe. And
you've been there?
Yeah, I did a few months in it. So, some guys, if they had high points, like guys, you would see guys get popped all the time that just came from the medium. They're like, this place is sweet. They're moving around too much. They buy a cell phone, they get popped right away.
Bam. And they go
back to the medium. Yep. So in my situation, our room got raided and they got into...
Now, how many people in the room?
12. 12 man rooms.
I've never been in more than 2
man rooms. There's 6 bunk beds, 3 on each side and 2 per bunk. You got one table, you each get a chair, and you each get a little locker. Like one of those half-size lockers,
sure,
with the double doors.
Right.
And that was the room. And there's communal showers and
bathrooms.
In that
12-man unit?
No, in the hallway.
Got it.
On each floor, there's communal showers, and there's 2 sets.
Sounds, I mean, a lot nicer than what I was at.
Yeah, I mean, it was a dump because it was an old army barracks, but it was still a lot of freedom. No cameras. There's one officer for like 400 inmates.
No cameras.
No cameras in these buildings at all.
Wow.
Yeah, it's crazy when you think about it that there's no fucking cameras.
I mean, especially with today's world, it's so cheap to put cameras everywhere.
Yeah, I think now that I read an article that the feds are starting to invest and upgrade cameras because there's a lot of crazy instances. And then at the end of each wing on each floor, so there's 2 staircases, one on each side, which was funny. So when the guard's coming up, everyone's running down the other staircase. And that would be like the rotation. But on each wing, there's 2 man cells.
Now, how many people in per unit?
About 400.
You had 400 people in this unit?
3 floors. Bottom floor is medical, like medical people with 2 man room medicals, with the pool table, a little workout area, the mail room. And the microwave room, which was like 4 microwaves, big area, communal area. And then the staff room and the unit officers room. And then there's two floors that are mimic each other. They mirror each other. Exactly the same.
This is just like boggling my mind.
Yeah,
you know,
it's like a, I'm telling you, it's a college dorm.
Yeah, I mean, I That's went to places is. Where people were getting killed.
Yeah, there's no locks on the doors. No one's getting killed. People are getting beat up. You know, they're getting checked in. Like you'd hear stories about on New Year's Eve, a guy got like a pole shoved up his ass in the stairway. There's a lot of sex offenders at Fort Dix. They're protected for the most part. This is a big sex offender compound.
Oh, so there's a lot of sex.
Oh, it's a Fort Dix is one of the biggest known sex offender compounds. People.
So rapists, is, and I don't mean like guys who go child molesters.
Yeah, it's if they have 20 years or less, they could be at the low. Even if they, you just can't get to a camp.
See, you know, my you know what boggles my mind, Ian, is when I was in penitentiaries. If somebody was found to be a sex offender, they were beaten viciously. I mean, from dropping buffing machines on their heads to fucking. And I was the one who used to pull that paperwork.
Yeah, at the
I
low.
I was a law guy, so I pulled the paperwork. And you know what that means.
Yep.
When you pull somebody's paperwork, you go into the docket sheet, and I can tell you what he's charged with and whatnot. And see, in the feds, if you are charged with a certain crime, it's, I think it was 18-something, USC 18, it was under 12 years old. Like, that means an adult fucking with someone under 12 years old.
Yeah.
If that happened, you were done.
Yeah.
And I often tell people, if you're a 20-year-old kid and you're fucking a 17-year-old, I don't give a fuck. We give you a pass. You know, it didn't matter.
Yeah.
So this prison you're in houses those kind of sex offenders, the ones I'm talking about.
And no one's fucking with them because they're like their own entity. People are even doing business with the sex offenders. But there are politics in prison, in these low-security prisons. Like, there's cars and you have to show your paperwork. But it's not strict to the point where, you know, the sex offenders get beat up because they're protected. No one wants to leave this low.
It's a beautiful place.
It's a beautiful place. They don't want to leave it. Fort Dix was a sweet compound. You could buy it if you wanted a cell phone. You could buy one for like $2,000. Drugs were crazy.
$2,000, though. It's not that cheap.
People were buying it, you know? Drugs, food. You want a hot meal. You know, you want smuggling. You want fresh meat. You want anything.
You want a meatball hero?
Yeah, you want liquor. They're making hooch. They're making White Lightning.
Oh, wow. We used to make that in prison.
Yeah, but anything you need, you could get on this compound. We would take, I had a bunkmate that had SIM cards smuggled in.
SIM cards, meaning for a cell phone.
Yeah, and the SIM card, we had an adapter where he would download movies onto the SIM card, and we'd watch new TV shows or new movies on the TVs downstairs at like 5 in the morning when a chill guard was working.
When you say, I'm just getting blown away here. So you had TVs you could watch stuff on?
We had TV rooms. So there were,
everybody has a TV.
Everyone has, yeah, we would take the thumb drive.
We had TV rooms too, but there's no cell phone shit.
No, oh, you could rent a cell phone. It's all contraband. But guys, this was a hustle for people. The Mexicans really had this down to a science. They had a phone and they would have lookouts, and you would go to the Mexicans and you would say, hey, I want to rent your cell phone time. It was like 15 mackerels. Or a book of stamps plus 5 mackerels for like 45 minutes. You would go in, sit on your bunk. They'd bring the phone. And the best part about renting is you don't have to worry about charging it. And you don't have to worry about stashing it. So you would sit there on the phone. You'd pay the rental fee or have a contract, put money on their books. And they would stand outside the room. And if the cops are coming, they'd run in, grab the phone and run. There's a hustle for everything at
Fort
Dix.
Oh my God, what a deal. I mean, geez, you're making me want to go back. No, not
really. Hey, you already called me out for that. But people are renting, that's a business, renting cell phone time in prison. And they're making a lot of fucking money. A lot.
Now, you can't tell me the officials don't know this is going on.
I think they do, but I think it's just too rampant, you know?
Right. It doesn't pay to keep
when you up. When you have campers that work at the prison yard, you're always going to have cell phones because it's so easy to throw it over the fence. You have corrupt guards. Sure. The guards, you know, if you figure if a guard's bringing in a cell phone that costs $200 to get and he's selling it to inmates for $1,000 who are then selling that for $2,000, you know, you're always
everybody's making
have
money. Yeah.
It's too profitable. And the drugs, you know, the only guards that aren't going to turn a blind eye are SIS.
Yep.
Because those guys are very, SIS. You know. Yeah, SIS.
They hated me.
Yeah, so it's just those types of situations. But there's always an influx.
Okay, so now Ian Bick is in the low at fucking Fort Dix.
Yep.
You don't belong, you don't believe you belong there.
No, don't believe
now
I
you
belong
go to your counsel. You go to your case manager. Yeah. So what the fuck am I doing here?
Well, he thought I was a sex offender when I first met him.
Whoa. Why did he? Let's show the picture. Is this why?
He didn't even look at my paperwork. And
is that why that picture?
That's why. He didn't even look at my paperwork. And he said, whoa, they're going to have fun with you. You don't really belong here. You know, you're going to have a hard time here. And I'm like, what do you mean? He's like, you know, you're one of them. I'm like, what are you talking about? And then he finally looks at the paperwork. And then once he realizes my story, Googles it, yada, yada. He's so curious about the nightclub, the parties. Anytime I talk to a prison official that knew my story, they're like, yo, how'd you steal the money? This and that. They were fascinated by that aspect. And so that was like the thing. But that's what happened with that. Get caught up in the investigation for cell phones. Go to the shoe. Clear to
how
the-
long do you?
I did 3 months. That was my first stint.
In the shoe.
They clear me for the investigation. They said, we're sending you to Danbury as a transfer.
They transfer you anyway, even though they clear you.
They transferred anyways. They transferred everyone in the room out, regardless.
Okay, a whole room you had.
They just transferred it. They split it up. You know, people were getting transferred out. The guy that was caught with the phone got an incident report, like the physical phone.
Now, they didn't give you any new time or anything?
No. I know in some cases they could charge you, but the prosecutor, think about how many cases that is.
I don't give a shit.
Some people, the unlucky, I feel bad for those people. There are people that do get charged with cell phones. You see it in the state a lot.
I'm telling you, it's an escape charge. Yeah, it used to be at least.
No, I think it still is. But you very rarely, I was talking, and when I was doing that speech in Florida, I talked to case managers. They said every phone gets sent out to the FBI that gets caught. They send it out to the forensics lab.
And they look at everybody who's ever made a phone call on it.
Yeah, they look at everything and they're connecting it. That's what SIS does. It's most of their job, looking at this shit. It keeps them busy all day. When I went to the SIS office, like when I was going to the shoe, because that's where they have drawers full of fucking cell phones and charge. It's crazy. It's literally
so
crazy.
So you go there for an investigation because you're just in the pot.
So
now you use the cell phone, so you know.
Of course you use the cell phone, but I was wrapped up. Like half of the room got wrapped up. They sent me to Danbury.
Danbury is in Connecticut.
Yep, which is my hometown. I'm excited to go.
Damn, I mean, this is great. And this is another law.
Yeah, but before I get there, I go to Brooklyn.
Back to MDC?
Back to MDC for a couple days, and then to Philly. This is where they're putting me through diesel therapy.
Okay, Philly, I know.
But you don't need to go to Philly. So there's
not.
A direct.
It's actually, yeah, it's opposite out of
the
direction.
And there's a direct route from Brooklyn to Danbury.
Absolutely.
But they bring me to Philly. The hurricane in Puerto Rico is happening, so all the buses are going out to Puerto Rico. So I'm stuck in the hole in Philly for 6 or 7 weeks, where they sell me up with a sex offender that had just got busted on the Fort Dix compound by the FBI for smuggling in kiddie porn. And I'm in the cell with him for 6 weeks, reading a fucking Bible because there's no other thing to read.
No,
yeah, and he's got like these romance novels, like these Christian romance novels.
And this guy's a sex offender.
I didn't realize.
A real sex offender?
He's a real, like, he didn't touch anyone, just looked at the sick
motherfucker. Who looks at child porn?
And he looks like it. He's got the bald head. He's got like the little goatee.
Easy. I got a boy.
No, like the chomo glasses, the goat. Creepy dude, you know? Really creepy. He was just finishing up a 10-year sentence, and he gets caught with this. And I look up his case months later, and I find out he gets like another 10 or 15 years crazy.
What an idiot. Not only is he a fucking chomo, he's an idiot chomo.
6 weeks go by, 7 weeks. I got one phone call because you get one phone call a month. My parents don't know where I am because when you're in transit, it doesn't populate on the site. And
know it 100%.
They bring me back to Brooklyn after that. So now I'm at Brooklyn for the third time.
MDC, back to Philly.
Back to Brooklyn, which didn't make any sense.
That's just fucking with you.
Yeah, that's almost 2 months later.
But why? Do you realize why?
Never. It's diesel therapy, man.
But usually, like, I was put on diesel therapy.
Yeah.
Multiple times.
Unless
they
made a mistake.
When I say diesel therapy,
yeah,
I mean fucking, how about fucking taking you on Con Air, first of all, once they take you on Con Air, they lose your paperwork.
Yeah.
Then they take you, and they one time dropped me off from Rhode Island.
Yeah.
And they fucking bust me down every state and county jail.
Well, this story gets worse.
Okay, go ahead.
I go to Danbury. Like, you can't make this shit up. I go to Danbury. This is great. I'm in with the Italians because there's some Italian guys that knew me from Danbury. A lot of, like, there's a lot of, like, Italian mob-related guys that are lived in Danbury, knew my story.
So they knew your story. This is the kid, yeah. The Whiz kid.
Everyone, there was a lot of guys that were in like New Fairfield, local towns that were in the Danbury prison serving time. I wasn't going to have a hard time about paperwork, nothing. They were going to take care of me. I got a care package, everything. Not even a full day goes by. I have one night's sleep in my bunk. I didn't even get a shower in yet. I get called to the lieutenant's office the next morning. And I'm like, what the fuck, man? I don't know what this is about. I go to the lieutenant's office. There's three guards there. And the lieutenant, they put me up against the wall. They search me and they handcuff me. And I'm like, what the fuck is this about? Like, I just got here. I think you guys made a mistake. They're like, are you Ian Bick? Your number? I'm like, yeah. They bring me the shoe. This shoe is like Alcatraz. It's three tiers long, three tiers high. It's got the bars on it. And it's a fucking, it overlooks. Yeah, it's crazy. They put me in the strip out cell. They have an empty first cell and I'm sitting there and I'm at the day I go into the shoe is the day they're doing their walks. You know, when everyone walks by the warden and everything.
We call it the dog and pony show.
Yeah. When, and so
the warden and the captain, they all walk around. So that's a Friday usually.
Yeah. This was like a Wednesday and I'm sitting there yelling at them. I'm like, guys, they got the wrong guy. Why am I in here? This and that. I'm in there. They put me in a cell. 2 days go by. Lieutenant finally comes around. Nice guy comes to me and said, listen, I'm not supposed to tell you this, but you've been placed under investigation because a guard reported that he knew you from the outside world. And that was deemed a conflict of interest. So they're investigating now. So I'm in that shoe now for almost 3 more months. Under an investigation, they finally clear me. I'm a state senator calling in every day. My parents are calling in every day. They make me.
You didn't do shit.
Yeah, I didn't do shit. I was just in this. They had to remove me from the compound because he was working on the compound.
Sure.
I dated his cousin. He came to my house for a barbecue. He was a super cop. Funny thing is, I would see guards that used to work as bouncers for me, and they didn't report shit, you know. But this guy was a super cop, and I was like, they made me the orderly of the thing because I wasn't there for any, you know, anything like that. So I was painting cells. I was doing the laundry. The CO called me Squints from Sandlot, and that's what I was doing. They finally ship me out, and they say the CO
from Danbury.
Yeah, they're like, after like 3 more months in the shoe, I'm in the shoe this whole time now, going on month 6 totally.
And everybody just to let them know, shoe means special housing unit, yep. or the hole.
Yep. And they're like, my case manager comes around. He's like, we got you to a camp. We're lowering your points. Cause at this point I've been in prison over a year. So I'm up for my yearly review. They dropped the points. Now I'm at like 8 or 9 points or whatever,
jeez,
which is what I should have been at originally. So I asked one of the cool guards and said, hey, what camp am I going to? And he says, it starts with an O. That's all he would tell me.
Otisville.
I'm thinking Otisville. I'm like, great. That's where I want to go.
You know, that's also the cheese factory.
Yeah, I've heard the word cheese factory. Yeah, for the medium for sex offenders.
For the rats. Yeah. They actually have WITSEC there.
Otisville camp is like the best camp you could go to in the feds. Heard about that.
But the WITSEC, it's called WITSEC,
yeah,
is where Witness Protection Program is for the New York area.
Yeah, so I'm like, great, I'm going to Otisville. Because there's not that, I could either go to Massachusetts or I could go to New York, which is close to my family, for Otisville, for a camp. Yeah. So they bring me to the tarmac at Stewart Air Force Base.
I've been there. I've been on that tarmac.
And in front of me, the bus pulls up. In front of me is the Con airplane that's surrounded by U.S. Marshals. And to the right is the bus that goes to the Otisville Medium and the Otisville Camp.
Well, they're all, the bus is going to the outer skirts.
Yeah, to different areas. Yeah. So I'm like, why are we going to a tarmac? I was talking to a guy. He's like, oh, no, that goes Otisville. That's the Otisville bus. They're lining us off the bus. We're on the tarmac. They're dividing people up. If you hear your name, go on the plane, yada, yada. They say, Bick, towards the plane. I'm like, I don't think I'm supposed to go there. And they're not telling me anything.
They don't say shit. They don't say shit. Trust me.
They said, you want to go back to Danbury? Get on the fucking plane. So I go on the plane. I'm handcuffed, chained up, shackled. I got a brown paper bag lunch while the fucking air marshals are eating Wendy's stuff in their face. Fat fucking... These guys look like they should be retired. These are huge. There was not one in shape air marshal on this plane. The plane
they
looks,
will beat your ass.
Yeah, it's crazy how their guns are. It's like all like the fingerprint lock, everything. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, it'll play.
So, the plane looks like it's from the fucking 70s. Looks like it's gonna fall apart. Yeah, it's crazy.
I've been on that plane when it had a fucking medical like an air emergency.
Yeah.
I'm a fucking shit in my pants. I was on that plane 16 times, more than 16 times.
So I'm like, this has been the worst 6 months ever between everything, you know? Now I'm on this plane. I don't know where we're fucking going because they don't tell you shit. End up in Oklahoma City where I was in the basement there or whatever, the holding center for like 4 hours. They're not telling you anything. People are pissing all over the place. There's that one toilet. Yeah, you're hungry.
It's a holding cell. Yeah. The fight's happening.
You got another cheese sandwich. There's like 400 guys. It's crazy. Finally make it up to the unit at like 1 a.m., you know, get some sleep. Yeah.
This is such reminders.
And this is Christmas time. I spend my Christmas there now at Oklahoma City. At least they gave me a Christmas bag, which was nice, but I couldn't take it with me because there was no like box out or whatever. And finally a case manager, a nice guy, comes. I get to talk to him. I said, listen, can you please tell me what's going on? I'm trying to get in touch with my family. Let me know. He said, you're going to Oxford prison camp. It's a great place.
Oxford, Wisconsin?
Yes. Oxford. I didn't even know we had an Oxford, Wisconsin.
Fucking Oxford.
Said the camp suite. I start asking around guys that have been in the area. And the thing about Oklahoma City, it's very gang related. Like the Mexican guys, like they're covered in tattoos. Like it's very gang related. And they're looking at me like I'm a sex offender. There's no paperwork because you don't have any paperwork. So I'm just trying to navigate and stay alive, you know, because I don't know what's going on. And there's nothing to do. You know, there's some TV, whatever. It's just like you're in idle mode when you're in these holdover centers.
Basketball court, which is bullshit. Yeah.
So I do a week there because they stop shipping out over the holidays or whatever. I do a week there. I'm back on the plane and they fly me to Chicago, sit on the tarmac for like 4 hours. They take me on a bus to MCC Chicago where I sat there through New Year's for another 2 weeks. That wasn't too bad, but it was still bad because it's another detention center. But you weren't in a cell. It was open dorm. I was on the open dorm floor.
I like cells better.
I like kind of open dorm. You have that freedom a little bit. I mean, it depends. I always had bad experiences with bunkies, always with a piece of shit bunkie. I never had a good cellmate. Okay. I think if I had a good cellmate, it was always someone that was unclean, didn't speak English, wasn't sociable, you know?
See, I never did. I was different.
It was always
I think they
bad.
Put penitentiary guys with penitentiary guys.
Yeah. So then after that, the only good thing about MCC was I talked to guys that knew about Oxford. They were pointing me what commissary items to get that I could resell. So I got Oreos. Oh. I got Chips Ahoy. I made a killing, you know? It took them like 2 months to get me my shit. But yeah, then they put me on the bus. I wasn't shackled because campers don't have to be shackled on the bus.
Really?
Yeah. So they
are you handcuffed?
No, nothing.
Nothing.
I was free to roam around on the bus. The other guys are. Yep. And that's how I finally knew they weren't fucking with me. I was going to a camp. It's like a 6-hour bus ride. They have all these stops. Make it to the camp in Oxford, Wisconsin. This is the beginning of 2018. I do the whole year there up until the time I'm released.
Okay, let me do a couple questions. How was the camp?
Camp's the coolest thing I've ever seen. Like, Orange is the New Black. These TV shows do not do this thing justice. It's a small camp. There's 120 inmates. There's one guard for this camp. There's four wings. There's a dog program. Inmates have
dogs.
Wait
a minute. So there's a one guard for the 120 inmates?
Yep, one guard that sits in the office in the middle. There's a full gym, full basketball court.
Is there a warden even?
Yeah, there's a medium security prison next door. That's why. Yeah, it's supported. Okay, it's a satellite camp.
Gotcha.
There's a track. There's a bocce ball court. There's a tennis court. There's two tennis courts. There's a full track. There's a volleyball court.
See, they had this like at Jessup. They had a camp, which is next to the medium. And the same thing. They had one guard just hang out, just does nothing, you know, watches the people. In fact, I did a video from the back end of the camp where you could actually come to see me if you wanted.
Yeah.
They actually saw my RV there and they closed the camp fucking down.
Oh, that's
it's really cool.
They would close the camp when we had celebrities get sentenced there, like George Papadopoulos from Trump's crew got sentenced. TMZ was outside.
George Papadopoulos went there?
Yeah, I met him. Yeah, I did. He spent 13 days there.
And what was he like?
He was cool. I mean, if he was at like a higher security prison, he'd definitely be labeled like a sex offender. He had like a
that look.
Yeah, he had a hot wife though that came to visit. It was just a whole spectacle. The prison system acts different when there's celebrities.
Really?
There, yeah, they tightened the place up. They were on high alert. It was just different because all the news is outside. You get very close because there's no fence or anything.
Right.
But the visiting room suite, like you have access to the visiting room during non-visit hours. There's vending machines.
Yeah, you can go to them anytime you want?
Yeah, not legally, but no one's watching, you know? No
but
one.
But how do you get
there?
You have money?
You'd have your family on the visit give you money. And you would
cash.
You get it smuggled in. You just slip it because there's an outside visiting porch too.
But don't you get searched when you come down with a visit?
There, that was the other thing. There's no strip searches. You just get patted down. No searches.
Wow, that's amazing.
Yeah,
fucking crazy.
The camp was crazy. Everyone's got a cell phone.
All right, now everybody's got a cell phone.
Yeah, there's cell phones. So everything.
Now you're there. You get out.
Yep.
And how do you start what you're doing now? Now, Ian, you are a YouTuber like I am. You do podcasts. You know, obviously you're an interesting guy. You're different. How do you do what you, how do you come to do what you do?
So when I got out, I was so focused on getting back in the nightclub business. I thought that was going to be my redemption story. And it wasn't. I found out really quickly, one, I didn't want to raise money or do that. Not that people would give me money, but it just wasn't going to work out.
Oh, you can get it. Yeah, people are stupid.
It wasn't realistic, though. You know, it wasn't the move. And it's a good thing I didn't, because COVID happened a year later and that would have killed anything I built up. Mm. So I go back to work for Whole Foods and I work my way up from a hot bar cook to a manager running the prepared foods department.
Oh, wow.
Making $33 an hour. And I was going to make over $100K with overtime because the overtime's insane. That allowed me to rebuild my life, rebuild my credit, get a car, get a dog, get my own place, get my own insurance, do everything that, like, I owned a nightclub at 18, but I was still living off my parents. I didn't have any money. I never had a car. My license was suspended. I didn't have anything.
Do you live alone now?
Now I have my own place.
Good for you.
An apartment.
And so Whole Foods did that, really?
Whole Foods gave me a life, like a normal life.
They knew you were a felon.
Yeah, they liked my work. No matter what happens in my life, like if the podcast doesn't work out or if anything doesn't work out, I can always go back to my work ethic and that will take me places.
Absolutely.
And I have that relationship with Whole Foods.
That's a great lesson to anybody. Obviously, I'm like that as well.
Yeah.
Work ethic is what keeps us keeping going.
Exactly.
And when people notice that. I want everybody out there who ever listens to my work ethic, and they all know me, they go, man, Larry, you post this. It's about a work ethic. It's keeping going. It's fucking pushing forward.
Yeah, so last August, or last July, my friend had been bugging me for like a year, said, get on TikTok. And I missed like that big TikTok wave, very anti-TikTok, but he's like, you got to tell your story. Because at this point, I had an HBO Max documentary done about me. I had a Vice documentary, but there was no new traction. I needed to put a fire onto it. So I said, okay, I'm going to start telling my stories on social media from like prison and stuff. I teach myself TikTok. I start posting stories. My fifth video I ever posted went viral, did like 1.3 million. And I always like to tell the story because I was sick in bed, like dying of COVID that day. And I didn't want to post, but my friend pushed me to. And that was the one that was my first viral hit. And you never know. It's the one you least expect, like we were talking about.
You know, it is funny. I'll do a video, and I'll say, it sucked. Because fucking nuts. And then I do a video. Oh, it's a great video, great video. It's flat.
Yeah.
You know, and I, that is so true what you said. But you now are working with Q29 Productions, which is great. They're a great studio. You are... making content every day, you're pushing out stuff. I'm gonna work with you. We're gonna work together.
I love it, Larry. Yeah.
I'm enjoying my time here, up here. I came up here with Ian and his guys and a bunch of people, and Nick and I are working here. Where do you see yourself going? Like you're young. I look at myself with a book and cigars. I have a lot going on, obviously. Where do you see yourself here in another few years?
I think that. So I'm always someone that like adapts and grows. Like I never thought I would have a podcast. Like I just figured social media. And then when you get into social media, you realize like the money's limited in social media itself. Like you have to diverse, you have to do different things and stuff. And I don't do things unless like I have a full idea and I'm like a very organized person. I have to see the full spectrum. I have to think about what's the potential of this. Whereas before when I was young, I never did that. I never analyzed the risk, what could happen, this and that. So I come up with the idea for the podcast. And to answer your question, I think that is like my calling. Like I'm getting, if you look at my first episode that I did on the podcast, where like I'm kind of uncomfortable, I'm just reading the questions to now being able to guide the podcast, carry it, diverse, ask good questions. I think I have a talent there. Mix that in with like this new public speaking journey that I'm doing. My first one was really good success and I'm starting to get booked on more. I think I could be like a leading podcast in my genre, because it's unique in a way with the stories. Like, we're incorporating prison meets inspiration, and it doesn't just apply to the person that's gone to prison. Like, you could listen to a story like yours or a story like mine, where we're individuals that have fucked up our lives on drastic levels, and we redeem ourselves from that. That's going to inspire the person that's sitting at home overweight, that needs motivation to get to the gym, is going through a divorce, is going through a job loss. Those are the stories that change these people's lives. And I think I have a very interesting market, especially with my point of view, because I've been to prison before.
You know, Ian, you're 100% right. I can't even tell you how many emails I get and comments I get. Hey, Larry, you helped me get off drugs. Hey, Larry, you survived me through this. You did this. And I always think, what do you mean? Like, you know, what the fuck? I'm a lot different. I'm an older guy, you know, and my goal in life is kind of like what yours is. But I even want to see younger guys like you take over or do more like what I do, or get into the rehabilitation game, get into the help game, get into the speaking game, get into the game, because you have a lot to offer. We need different parts of a component, and you have it, whether it's Q29 Productions or you have the, it all encompasses everything. And the more we realize that, and the more we can try to, with the basis of, I want to help somebody. I want to make sure somebody doesn't make the stupid mistakes I made to go to prison. But I also like to show people that I like to have fun. I don't give a fuck. I want to have fun. I will have drinks. I'm no role model. I like to have fun. I'm responsible, though. I'm not going to sit and get fucked up and drink and drive. I'm not going to hurt somebody. I'm not going to jeopardize my life over something stupid anymore. So I always often tell people, if you hear me get arrested, I was set up. It's the truth. Yeah. I have to say this with you. You've been an amazing person. I mean, meeting you for the first time, and we've talked and stuff like that. You got a great thing going. I don't want you to quit. I don't want you to ever think get down. Things are going to go up and down. You're going to find it. You know that. I think you know that already. You're already at that point. You got good guys here in Q29, and you got good guys all around you. And you hope you have me now with you and to help and keep going with all we're doing. We're going to do a lot of more stuff, but what else do you want to say? What do you got to promote? Because I'm going to put all your information in the links below.
I appreciate that.
I'm going to put everything in. You know, we're going to put them in.
But, you know, that's what I like about you is, like, you've always been, like, we got to help each other. Like, I like helping guys. Some of these bigger people, not even just in our field, they don't help. You know, like, I'll do podcasts. Big podcasts. They don't even plug in where to find me. Anything like that. You know, I've had people on the show, they didn't even post a clip from the podcast.
Well,
you know?
You're going to get me posted a lot of clips, and you're going to post Nick's already going to post everything, and yeah, he's probably posted something already. No. If I don't doubt it. Look, he did.
But
he's going to post stuff.
My thing's very simple. It's just ianbick.com, and that links to everything. It links to the podcast, links to all my social media. So that's where people could find me, just ianbick.com, and that'll get them to all of my stuff.
And, you know, Ian Bick's story is amazing. He's going to be coming out with a book. We talked about that. I hope he does. My stuff's out there, but I'm going to put his stuff again in my links below. You'll hear about it. You can go anywhere. And please, just look at what he does. And people can make it. No matter what mistakes they make, everybody can turn their life around. I often tell, and I always end every show, every video I ever do, is please make good choices. Don't go down the path I went. And everybody out there has to realize that no matter what happens to you, the sun's gonna rise, and no matter what happens, we're all gonna move forward. And I want to thank you for coming on the show. I really appreciate
Thanks
it.
Thanks for having me, Larry.
You're a good guy.
I appreciate it.
Stay strong. Thank you again, Q29 Productions. Thank you, everybody. Stay tuned to our next podcast. We will be there. Have a great day and make good choices.